Dan, I don't know about you, but I am fired up about the Bears' third-string quarterback. He's Dan Wiederer from the Chicago Tribune. I'm Dionne Miller from ABC7. Bears quarterbacks, 1 week in, we have gotten the whole spectrum, right? We've gotten the veteran leader. We've gotten the rookie, the confident, not cocky, confident rookie, and the incredibly passionate, someone, please give me a job, third-string quarterback. I'm all over the place with my emotions about this. Where are you at?
I thought Monday was an incredibly fun day because one after another, they came to the podium. You had QB1, QB2, QB3, Andy Dalton, Justin Fields, Nick Foles, and all of them have three very different existences right now at the start of August 2021. And we were able to kind of dive in to each of their existences one at a time and go through it all. I think obviously the headliner of the day was Foles, which shouldn't be the case, but Nick Foles hadn't spoken with us since last November, since before he was preparing to play the Vikings. When he sat down at the podium, I said, "Hey, Nick, we haven't talked to you in a while. What's new?" And he kind of laughed and said, "A lot's new," because you think about all that's gone on in his life since the last time we talked to him. He got injured against the Vikings. Mitch Trubisky took his starting job from him. Yeah. Bears went out in March and signed Andy Dalton and said, "Hey, we've got no confidence in you. Here's Andy Dalton." Then they drafted Justin Fields. And all of a sudden, you had a former Super Bowl MVP as your number three quarterback. And one of the narratives that had kind of persisted since the spring and into the first part of training camp is, how cool is it to have a former Super Bowl MVP as your number three quarterback? And I was the whole time saying, well, wait a minute. We can't gloss over the reality that Nick Foles was traded for. The Bears paid Nick Foles handsomely. The Bears thought Nick Foles could be a reliable answer as their starting quarterback. The fact that he's their number three quarterback now and no one has ever really answered why is a problem. Nick Foles tried to give us some answers in some sort of passive-aggressive, roundabout, impassioned ways. I'm curious what you think you learned from that. I think, what was it, 9 minutes with Nick?
I don't know. He was a presence when he came in, right? And different than we'd ever seen him last year when he was the starter. He never even acted that way. He said he was a different quarterback than he was when he won the Super Bowl. I believe him. He was very passionate. And I had so many more questions I wanted to unpack. His frustration that you could clearly hear with what had gone on the year before and the position he's in right now. I just had so many layers I wanted to keep peeling back because it had been so long since we talked to him. And he did seem way more passionate about what he's doing now than I wish he played that way, right? Like he just never seemed to bring that kind of intensity. And it was, he stole the headlines that day. And I think that was kind of his point, is that he wanted to speak his mind. He wanted to share the things that he had been thinking about and working on and feeling. I feel like there's so much more there from behind the scenes with the Bears. And you bring up such a good point that no one's really explained why the Nick Foles experiment did not work, right? We hardly know why the Mitch Trubisky experience didn't work other than his inability. That's basically why. But, you know, you think about that quarterback room a year ago and how much the Bears invested in moving up to get Mitch and then how much they gave up to get Nick Foles and to have them both fail. There's a lot going on there that I want more answers to.
There's zero question that this is at the epicenter of everything involving the Chicago Bears right now, because the failures with Trubisky, the failures with Foles have reset the timeline with a defense that was Super Bowl ready in 2018, 2019, 2020. And now all of a sudden you've got a new timeline for them to navigate because you're redoing the quarterback position yet again. As far as Foles goes, I had a league source elsewhere in the league who saw Nick Foles' comments from Monday and said that was calculated. And he said that was like Nick rolled a grenade into the room and walked out. And what I found interesting about it, remember, we've seen this Nick Foles before, this passionate Nick Foles before. If you remember after that Carolina win last year, it was kind of a ho-hum win. And he came to the post game and he was about ready to jump through the Zoom screen because he was talking about listening to Meek Mill and he was just felt something special with his team. And he was so happy that it's hard to win in the football at NFL, the National Football League. And he was so juiced up. And it was invigorating. We haven't talked to Nick in 9 months, 10 months maybe now it is. And so to get that back in there, you say, okay, there is more. I came right to your cubicle after he was done and said, I want 25 minutes with Nick Foles behind closed doors with a bottle of truth serum to see if he really tell us. Because I asked him directly. I said, Nick, you've had a chance now to reflect on why things didn't work out for you as a starting quarterback in 2020 with the Chicago Bears. What conclusions did you come to? And he basically said, I could tell you, but I can't tell you here, right?
Right. Yes.
I don't want to cause problems, but there was clear he had a lot more to say. And when you talk about the failure of Foles alongside the failure of Trubisky, the question that needs to be answered in some way, shape, or form is, are they related? And if they're related, is it because Matt Nagy isn't good at syncing up with his quarterbacks? If that's the case, Andy Dalton and Justin Fields, beware. If that's the case, Chicago, buckle in. Your stomach's going to be turning throughout the rest of the 2021 season. And so Nick's comments, based on what he experienced last year, were telling, eye-opening, attention-grabbing, all those things, and they made you just want a little bit more detail.
No question about it. And if it is a Nagy issue, we're about to find out, and it's going to cost him his job because this is his quarterback in Justin Fields. And
Andy.
What'd you say?
And Andy.
Oh, and Andy. Yeah, 1,000% and Andy. And yet, we've talked about it already, what we've seen from Dalton, even different than any quarterback that the Bears have had in a very long time, is just his assertion of what he's doing and his there are no hesitation, right? There's no hiccup. There's no wonder. There's no why am I doing? He's done it, and you can see it. And that has been very different. And so I don't know how much Matt can do with that, but with Fields, if he's unable to tap into making him that elite franchise quarterback that they are expecting him to be, that's very telling about a head coach who is offensive minded and wants to be calling the plays and wants to have his hands all over the quarterback. I mean, yikes, buckle up is exactly right.
So here's a couple thoughts I have after the first six practices of training camp. Number one, it really seems like Andy Dalton's confidence and comfort is contagious, right? Yeah. It's making the people around him feel more at ease about his control of the offense. That's meaningful, right? Even if it's not always backed up by high-level production, if you can make the other guys in the huddle and the other guys in the meeting room feel like you've got this, all of a sudden the anxiety levels come down. And right now, Andy Dalton has brought the anxiety levels down. You hear it when Matt talks. You hear it when Bill Lazor talks. You hear it when the wide receivers talk. Darnell Mooney said last week, look, when Andy got in the huddle in OTAs and we'd never worked with him before, it was just different. It felt like we had been running these plays with him forever. Okay, mark that down in your notebook and say, okay, there's a belief in Andy right here. You got to be able to sustain that belief into regular season meaningful action. That's going to be the challenge for Andy. But I can tell you it's looked smoother in training camp. And just that sense of calm and confidence is there. Now with Fields, we talk a lot about his presence, his athleticism. One of the things that's really jumping out is when he does have those plays where it's not there and right, he decides to let his instincts activate his legs and he takes off. All of a sudden you see, whoa, you know, that's quick. And you see defenders coming and chasing after him. And you say, that's elite speed. And that's one of those things where if Matt Nagy is flawed as an offensive overseer, Justin Fields' ability to take a 6-yard sack and turn it into a 13-yard gain in a first down is going to change everything that we think about Matt Nagy based on nothing that Matt Nagy did other than using Justin's legs, right? And so that's one of those advantages that the Bears should have going forward with this kid as their starting quarterback eventually that is going to make a huge difference. And it's just going to look different and it's going to feel different and drives are going to go longer because he's got the ability to take a screwed up play and turn it into something positive.
Yeah, but remember, greatness doesn't happen overnight. So we will be patient for that. But one thing I want to point out at Family Fest, I mean, every time he was near the ball, there was an audible buzz in the stadium and they cheered absolutely everything he did. And I get back to what we talked about his confidence, not cocky confidence. And Nagy even talked about that this week, is that he doesn't let something negative weigh him down, because he's like, I know I can make the play. I know I can make the pass. I know that I can do it. And we've not heard that before. And just to see that, coming out of him, that he is that confident and ready for whatever they throw his way and making those steps towards being better and being ready for when his name is called. I think it's already been cool to see that happening.
He also has a clear awareness of the process. And I think that's cool as well, because you mentioned that quote, greatness doesn't happen overnight. He said it multiple times. And I think that's his way of telling the outside world, I know you want me to be the Bears starter yesterday. I know you want me to be the Bears starter today, tomorrow, and as soon as humanly possible, but I still got a lot to learn. I'm comfortable knowing that I've got a lot to learn. I'm comfortable knowing that I am going to learn all those things because I know what my intelligence is, what my work habits are. It's going to happen. It's just not going to happen right away. You talked about a boiling pot of water with the whole slow boil to the regular season. Well, Justin Fields' pot is on the stove and we don't even see the ripples of bubbles yet. When we do, we'll tell you. And it's going to be very exciting when that's starting to come. But his awareness of that is as important as anything in this process, because it allows him to do what the coaching staff is asking him to do, which is stay present, stay in the now, right here, right now, work on what you're asking, being asked to work on today, this week, et cetera. And every little step will result in a giant step for the Chicago Bears.
Here's what I will say too. I mean, that fast, he is the most popular athlete in our city. That fast. At Family Fest, the number of the two most popular jerseys we saw, Khalil Mack and Justin Fields, and they were everywhere. And I, it's just telling, I mean, this is a Bears town and people are excited about this, and he doesn't seem like the pressure will get to him, right? I mean, am I misreading him? I don't think he's overwhelmed by that at all. We even asked him about seeing his jersey on fans at training camp, and he's just like, I've seen it before. And I mean, just not, he's not caught up in anything other than being a great quarterback, trying to be a great quarterback and being competitive about it. That hopefully is what will continue his progression towards being ready when they call him.
He's very poised, and you bring up a good point. Rich Campbell and I, in the dark days of 2016, used to talk about how you'd look out at Soldier Field and it would be like a 9-to-1 ratio of jerseys of former Bears greats and current Bears players. There was, you know, you'd see a Kyle Long here or there. You'd see, you know, a jersey here or there of a Cutler, right? But it was mostly Urlacher and Ditka and Peyton and Singletary. Mm-hmm. And now when you start to see the stands fill up with guys who are on the current team, that's usually a promising sign. We'll see where Justin Fields is able to take it. His poise is certainly notable and has shown itself both in interviews and on the field during camp. Back to Nick Foles for a minute, because the one thing that I thought was interesting was it was almost like a bit of a hostage video intended for Frank Reich in Indianapolis, where he was basically right. Like, Frank, your quarterback's foot is hurt. We love each other. I love you. You love me. You won a Super Bowl with me in Philly. Come get me, please. Somebody please come get me right now. I don't want to be here anymore. I'm happy to be here. I'm going to do what they ask me while I'm here, but I don't want to be here anymore.
I don't want to be here. Exactly. And how much, I mean, he could not have saying Frank Reich's praises more than saying he adjusted the offense and you saw what we were able to do and da da da. And it's like, okay, so what are you saying about Matt Nagy in that too? Like, I wanted so much more from that. So maybe we'll get one more swing on his way out. Whenever that may happen, he'll be able to tell us a little bit more and we'll see.
Calculated, right? Calculated. Bite the pin off the grenade, chuck it in, and head for cover.
I should laugh. I mean, mission accomplished. He got our attention. No question about it.
There's no question about it. We hope we have your attention out there. We've got a lot more videos to come throughout training camp and the preseason. Remember to like this video, subscribe to this channel. So much more to come. Dionne, this is picking up steam. I feel momentum for the first time in a while because we're out there all the time.
It's so much fun. Life-giving, if you will.
We'll continue to give you life. Stick with us.